first of all, what do you all understand by mom and marketing? You know, it's a different word. Okay, somebody sent a message. Yeah, it's advertisements inspired through current events and trends. Yes, that's absolutely the point that we're looking at. So what we'll be in this webinar today, you'll be understanding a few things like what is moment marketing, some clear examples of moment marketing. So you understand this concept of moment marketing or ambush marketing, and especially the legal aspects around it. Obviously, it's a legal webinar, so we'll be touching only about the legal aspects about it. What are the other legal challenges that are faced when anybody indulges in this kind of a practice? So we'll elaborate about on all of these aspects. Marketing, of course, is very, it's not something which is, you know, unknown to each of us. Even a small child has many experiences of marketing. Even if you put on a kids channel today, how many advertisements come on it? How many, if you go and attend a tournament, you will see that the players are wearing a t-shirt, but that t-shirt will at least have, you know, few, if it's an important tournament, there'll be many logos on it. So marketing means specifically creating a space for yourself in the market wherein, you know, people really want to promote their products. Now, when we come to moment marketing, what is meant by moment marketing essentially is it's a marketing approach where businesses and entities, they want to take advantage of some current event about which everybody is talking. Like, you know, if there is something like if a big tournament is happening, we all live in world of events these days. You know, there are World Cups, then there are tournaments, then there are other kind of events which happen, which are very, very popular. Now, any event will obviously have a sponsor. There are official sponsors. These sponsors have, they have exclusive rights to themselves. Sponsorship of something like Wimbledon, sponsorship of a World Cup, sponsorship of a big IPL event, or recently concluded the women IPL, any kind of big tournament you think about. So there are sponsors, they have their exclusive rights, they have the exclusivity to use the official marks, the logos, the taglines, anthems. You know, there are many things which revolve around a particular event, and the whole focus is on creating a whole atmosphere that everybody's talking about the event. But what happens is sometimes on this whole event wherein, you know, the sponsor is working, he's spending time, money, effort, the organizers are working, somebody else just wants to come through and they want to take an advantage of this event without really, you know, taking the consents or without really bothering to take the necessary permissions to use the logo. So this is typically moment marketing. So all moment marketing is not really illegal. There are some kind of challenges which are around this concept. Legal challenges are always there. But how to use this? So typically something like a parasite marketing will make you feel that, you know, you're not doing anything and you're just using somebody else's thing. But there are ways and means of doing it. So typically when you look at moment marketing, the first thing which always, what comes to our mind? Somebody who always uses moment marketing. Something like Amul. If you see Amul, they will always cash in on the current event which is happening, but they will do it in their own way. They will not use the logo of somebody else. They have to do it in their own way. They're just commenting. So all of these aspects are okay. Like, you know, if you look at this advertisement which has come, it's called Early to Worley. This is about a bridge which was being launched. So, you know, it eased everybody's, the traffic woes were supposed to be eased after the launch of this ceiling. So they commented on this in their own way. When we look at Zomato, so Zomato also uses, so moment marketing is very, very common. Everybody uses this. Now, suppose 15th August 1947, it was our Independence Day. So we see something saying not accepting orders anymore. So, you know, this is something wherein a current event is turned in a particular manner, or a current event is used to make your own statement about your own products, services, or generally also make a statement about it. So you're making most of the moment. Recently, we had a lot of things about the seatbelt. So there was a very unfortunate accident. And after that, you know, everybody realized the importance of seatbelt. So people have been, you know, making statements around it. And it is, of course, sometimes it hits us also, because when we are reading about the same thing everywhere, but, you know, looking at that thing from a different angle will somewhere, you know, enlighten something in us. So that's very important. So moment marketing, the concept is that when there is a moment, people want to use that to make it around their marketing campaign. Now, of course, there are some legal challenges which always are around this concept of moment marketing, ambush marketing, parasite marketing. The first challenge that is always there is the personality rights. Now, sometimes we'll see that, you know, the moment belongs to that particular person. Or, you know, the sports person who was really responsible for creating that victory for his country is the one who has created that moment. Now, it's his moment. We cannot cash in on it. So, we'll see more about it. You know, right now, we're just listing the issues. So, personality rights is a one bigger challenge. Celebrity rights, personality rights. They are recognized across jurisdictions, whether in India or whether abroad. Then apart from that, IPR issues, so intellectual property rights. So we must remember that when somebody is creating something, it belongs to that person, that entity, that organization. It cannot be just copied because it is there. Now we will, you know, all of us read books all the time. Now, if you look at a famous book like Seven Habits of Effective People, written by Stephen Covey. So all of us, you know, it's a very, very popular book. We all know that book. We all know the concepts that they've been discussing there. But it belongs to the copyright in that book. The concept, it belongs to the author there. So when we are talking about any IPR issues, so what we are saying is that when we cash upon somebody else's IPR, IPR issues are going to come up and legal challenges are bound to arise. Then there are also endorsement know-hows, which have been recently floated by the Consumer Ministry also in India. And we will see more about it on how these endorsement know-hows, on how these endorsement things work. You know, who is supposed to endorse? What are the guidelines applicable for endorsement? So all these legal challenges are there. And apart from that, of course, general guidelines are always applicable. So ASCII has floated many guidelines about advertisement, false advertisement. So any kind of marketing is always subject to general laws. And moment marketing is also subject to similar laws. But there are certain other challenges which we have seen of late. Now, when we look at the celebrity rights or the personality rights, we must remember that the definition of celebrity is not really defined anywhere. Like how we see the definition of a proposal or of an acceptance in a contract act, or we might see other definitions in other statutes. There's no definition of the celebrity, the word celebrity. So we don't have like a celebrity rights act so and so here in India. But the celebrity rights are recognized. Celebrity rights are recognized under Article 19 and 21 both under the Constitution. And many celebrities have of late. So what happens, like, you know, which celebrity comes to our mind? Say Amitabh Bachchan. So can I just open a shop tomorrow and say, you know, amitabhbachchan.com, or can I open a website which says ratantata.org and sell my own books there or sell my own videos there? I can't do anything like that. So it belongs to that person, that the name is associated with that person. The celebrity has certain rights in India and everywhere and in most other jurisdictions also. So they have a right of publicity. They have a right of privacy. We cannot use their names without their permission. So celebrities have always been very, sometimes very zealous also. Sometimes, of course, if it's gone unnoticed, it's a different story. So you might see, you know, random things somewhere where you go to a small town. You might see a small toffee which has a photo of a local actor of that particular region. So maybe that person is aware, not aware. We don't know. But typically, celebrities are zealous, and right of famous personalities are always recognized in jurisdiction. So you cannot just sell somebody cashing in on the hard work that other person has created in creating his own brand, creating his own reputation around it. Now, one common example of moment marketing, which is we've been seeing, and which after which mostly this concept came, you know, really into limelight, and there were many discussions around it last year as well, was about our favorite badminton player, PV Sindhu. So once she won the Olympics, so there were many brands which kind of tried to congratulate her through after she won the Olympics, and which did not really have a contract with her, or they did not have her permission also. But the advertisements were projected in such a way that it looked like an endorsement. It looked like, you know, she is a brand ambassador also of, you know, so many other brands. So there were about 20 people who congratulated Sindhu publicly, and there were no agreements about it. So there were many newspaper reports that Sindhu was planning to sue almost 20 brands with, you know, huge damages running into crores of rupees. So obviously, you know, if somebody has built up their personality, so I cannot just use somebody else's photo somewhere and start congratulating them and use their victory or use their moment to promote my brand. So this is something which we must remember, and which is very important, that celebrities, there are of course certain exceptions also to this. So no rights are absolute generally. You know, you'll always have reasonable restrictions to it. You'll have some exceptions to it. You'll have ways to deal with it. But Celebrity rights, one thing, are definitely granted. So we must remember that if a particular moment, or you know, if a particular victory, or if a particular time, or if that particular achievement belongs to a particular celebrity, then we must ensure that there are necessary permissions in place. We'll see more about best practices later on also. But we don't randomly utilize somebody else's moment for creating our own space for marketing or, you know, promotion. Now, there are certain judgments also which have come on celebrity rights. So, of course, we all know Rajinikanth. So, there was one movie which was prepared, which was being made, and it was called Main Hoon Rajinikanth. Now, on this movie, there was no authorization which was obtained by Rajinikanth. Now, what the producer and the movie claimed was that, you know, there is no need of getting any authorization in the first place because we don't, there is no connection. But the movie was objected to, and it was successfully objected to, and the movie was not allowed because celebrities have a right to control their image, which also includes their style, their voice, you know, their photos and other things. Otherwise, you know, it's very simple that somebody has created a big space for themselves and then people just use it to tarnish them. So celebrity rights have celebrities once they become celebrities, and once they are famous, they have their own ways of enforcing things. And these rights are recognized under Article 21 and Article 19 both. Now, as I said earlier, that, you know, the celebrity that, like any rights in India, these rights are also not absolute. There are always exceptions around a particular right, and there are always some reasonable restrictions which come with it. Now, this particular case, just this occurred in April 2023, very recent judgment of the Delhi High Court. So this was around the celebrity rights, the sponsorship rights, the, you know, some kind of between two platforms, which are called Rario versus Striker. So the digital player cards were in question here. So what happened here was that there were these two platforms. So I think we are, most of us are aware about the online fantasy games and the sports, which, you know, when cricket is like the craze for us. For us, it said that cricket is the religion of India. So when we talk about cricket players, obviously the cricket players are the stars. And once they become stars, it's not very easy for us to, you know, use their images or use their photographs or use their voice to sell something without their consent. Now, suppose I was to open a sports shop tomorrow. And if I start, you know, putting, showing as if, yes, you know, the shop is owned by Sachin, or the bats here are approved by him, or, you know, I've taken his suggestions. Obviously, that's not going to be right. So what happened here was one of the platforms, they were using the digital player cards for certain cricketers. And those cricketers had signed their sponsorship agreements and signed their contracts with the other platform, which was the plaintiff here in this case, which was Radio. So they objected to it, obviously, and they said that we have an exclusivity with respect to these players, and their personality cannot be used to create digital player cards without our permission. So this was the objection. Now, here what had happened was that the parties were also, what weighed in the minds of the court was also that parties had exchanged certain correspondences, and it was known that, you know, this kind of a thing is happening, because we must also remember that when it comes to cricket, there are a lot of statistics which are available online also, and there's a lot of information which is freely available in the public domain. So the way the digital player card was created, it was not showing any kind of endorsement, or it was not showing any kind of sponsorship per se. And there was no misrepresentation, was what the court said at any point in time, that the defendant has not really shown it in a particular light that, you know, he has the endorsement or he has something which he doesn't have. So the representation was held to be correct. And the court also said very, very clearly that use of celebrity names or images for the purposes of lampooning, satire, parodies, art, scholarship, music, news, and other similar uses are permissible. So we must remember that if a celebrity is acting in a particular movie, if somebody wants to write a critique on that movie, and if somebody wants to criticize something, somebody wants to make a satire on it, so all of that is obviously permissible. They don't work in isolation. It's not as if a celebrity has their own rights and they work in an island where, you know, nobody can take anything. That's not the case. We all know, you know, I mean, there are many cases wherein If there's a movie, somebody wants to criticize that movie. So obviously the photo of that movie will be put in the newspaper, the characters, their images, and you know, there will be some kind of usage of it. But of course, nobody's trying to say that we are getting an endorsement from them. So all of these, which you see, these are exactly the paragraphs which we have taken from the judgment. So these have been held to be permissible usages of the celebrity names and their images. So this was what had happened in this case. Then also at the same time, the court also said that, you know, there was no rationale or there was no connectivity between those DPCs or other the digital player cards which were being used and any kind of an active representation from the defendant's side that what is happening really. You know, they had not misused somebody's autograph or some to show some authorization which they didn't have. So in this case, the court said that the usage of those images, the publicly available images in the format in which it was used was permissible. So this was allowed in this judgment. It's a very, very interesting judgment which has come last week. And if you do get your hands on it, it will be very interesting for you to read it as well. Now, another main legal challenge, which is always there around any campaign, which is, revolving around moment marketing, is that there is always an IPR issue which might come up. Now, as I said earlier, that, you know, whenever we talk about events or whenever we talk about some kind of, you know, big programs which are happening. So here we have, they'll have their logos, they'll have their taglines, they'll have their color combinations, they'll have everything will be created uniquely for that particular event with a lot of effort from the organizers, from the designers, from the creative team. So they are absolutely zealous about protecting such things. And if somebody just takes the logo from somewhere to congratulate an athlete somewhere, it's not going to be very, very kindly looked at. So of course, you know, there are how we use the IPR, that is also very, very important. So infringement of a third party right is a very serious third party claim which can be faced in this thing. Now we look at, you know, I always like to explain things through an example. So let's look at an example again when we see here. Now, one very important example is there was this case of 2003, wherein it was a World Cup, Cricket World Cup was happening, and Philips wanted to give free tickets through its lucky draw to the winners of the lucky draw to that particular World Cup. And what happened in this case was this usage of the term World Cup was objected by ICC, and what they said was that this is not really permissible because, you know, it's our logo and they had their mascot, and I think in 2003, it's a long time back, but as far as I recollect, they had I think something in black and white at that point in time. So the only thing that was happening was defendants had booked the travel packages through the authorized agent who was appointed by UCBSA, and the plaintiff was kind of objecting to this kind of a campaign of free tickets. What the court said was that they're not using the mark. They're not using the logo also. All that they were doing was they were offering the tickets as prizes in their advertising campaign. And the judge very categorically held that he had seen the advertisements and read the printed material. I am unable to find that these advertisements in any way suggest that the defendant's business is approved, authorized, or endorsed by the plaintiff. So the facts in this case are very important. We cannot simply say that, you know, usage of you cannot do anything about it. What is possible? What is not possible? What is exactly being taken? Or rather, you know, is there any misrepresentation being done? Is there any possible association which is being shown? So getting into the details or getting into the facts is very important. We must remember that, you know, just copying some words or, you know, just taking something from somewhere, we are talking about that thing will not make you open for a claim really. But the facts of that case, what have you exactly done, is going to matter a lot. Now, at the same time, another case happened wherein around 2003 again. So this was around the same campaign of World Cup. And here they had taken the logo. The logo had been taken and the promotional campaigns was there, which used the logo depicting the black and white stripes of the zebra. So this logo was considered to be an artistic work under the Copyright Act. And it was said that because you've used the logo and you have no material to show that where are you allowed to use it and how are you allowed to use somebody else's logo, the legal action succeeded in this case. So we must remember that, you know, always it's not possible for somebody to tell you clearly that, you know, this is the straitjacket formula. The formula is only this, that you have to be careful. You have to make sure that you don't take somebody else's idea. It's not riding on somebody else's thing. If somebody is trying to take advantage, or somebody is trying to take rather an undue benefit of somebody else's work, the law is always going to catch up. So this is very important for us to remember, like, you know, protection is available. It's a catch-all protection, what we call. You know, everything is going to be protected under some form or the other, whether it is logo, whether it is the anthem, whether it is a tagline. So we must remember that taglines are also very important, and it takes a lot of effort for somebody to come up with a tagline. Symbols, the recorded event, films, everything is protected in some form or the other. So trying to cash on, or, you know, going on somebody else's moment is going to definitely attract some or the other form of issues and some form of legal action, in is what we have seen in the past as well. Now, moving on to the, so we saw that there were four kind of, you know, I mean, these are just, we are covering in brief, the four kind of possible legal challenges that we could face would be, first would be, of course, the celebrity rights we saw in Sindhu's example, or, you know, any other person whose moment it is, we cannot really encash on that moment. Then we looked at IPR. So IPR of a particular event, or, you know, the logo, tagline, anthem, mask, whatever is the mascot. So all of these belong to the particular sponsor or particular the organizers. So we cannot really take that in. Now, there is a new guideline which has come on 6th March 2023, which has come from the Department of Consumer Affairs. Now, this is very important for us to know. What we're talking about here are the endorsement know-hows. Now, what are these endorsement know-hows? Endorsement, these are guidelines which have been floated, which is to prevent any kind of misleading advertisement and any kind of misuse of certain images of certain people. So typically we'll see off late that, you know, there are certain celebrities, influencers, virtual influencers, and all of these, they operate on the social media. So when the guidelines specifically say that there is a responsibility which is applicable on each of these influencers or celebrities to specifically disclose any kind of material connection when they have, so that people are not misled in any manner. Sometimes if, you know, somebody is getting a hidden gift somewhere, or if there's an indirect benefit or some kind of a barter, contest entry. So all of these are covered within material connection. So this is from the point of view of celebrities. So we must remember that if somebody is using some other person's photo or some influencer, so it's not possible anymore to just use it without really, you know, disclosing the whole relationship. So this material connection disclosure is a mandate now. Now, how should the endorsement be made is also been laid down in these know-how and these guidelines. So it should be very clear. You know, it should be clear and it should be visible that it's an endorsement, really. It's an advertisement or it's a paid promotion. Sometimes, you know, people want to adopt techniques of, you know, showing that it's really not a paid promotion and somebody is genuinely giving their view. But that's not really the case. And behind the back, if there are some indirect benefits which have come, like, you know, we saw the examples in the last slide, say, you know, some contest entry, some kind of barter, some kind of gift, some kind of in-kind, you know, in-kind gift or consideration has been given. So all of that would form a part of material connection. It needs to be disclosed now. Then it needs to be clearly said that it was an advertisement, it's a sponsored thing, it's a paid thing, or there's a, you know, all of that needs to be used. Then it's also very important that individuals have been told not to endorse product or services which has not been personally used or experienced by them, or some kind of due diligence has not been done. So it's not simply possible that, you know, I just get up and I endorse somebody or I do something for them. I should know what it is about. Then if there are any disclaimers or if there are any disclosures to be made, they cannot be made in that small font of 6 or 7 somewhere in the bottom of the slide where you can't really make out what is being said. The disclosure should be clear. It should be prominent. It should be very hard to miss. So these are the words which are used also. Then again, celebrities or influencers, they are required to review. They have to satisfy themselves that the advertiser is in a position to substantiate the claims which are made in a particular advertisement. So sometimes you see that somebody is making a claim of, you know, getting the freshest possible tomatoes, or some, or, you know, they are advertising a cosmetic. So, you know, if they make some huge claims, so is it really possible? Because advertisements, and as much as the responsibility as the producer or the person who is making the advertisement has, also the celebrity who is endorsing it, they also have some responsibility now. So it's important that zealousness is maintained on both angles so that public is not misled. we must remember that the whole purpose of these guidelines, which have been floated by the Department of Consumer Affairs, is to ensure that public is not misled in any manner. Public is not misguided in any manner to believe something or to know something which does not exist really. So all that is very, very important. We must remember and we must keep a very close, eye on all these aspects. Now, placement of disclosure, we said that, it's very important. It should be something which is hard to miss. It should not be something which is kind of superimposed on an image, which is, it just comes and goes. You don't realize what is happening there. It can be in both video and audio format. Then it should be in the same language. It should not be that the endorsement is in, say, Hindi, and I use the disclosure in, say, some other language, which is not commonly known. So that is very important. And this is basically to make sure, just for the sake of ensuring, the core objective is always to make sure that, nobody is misled. Now, when we look at it from the angle of moment marketing, what I wanted to show was, why are celebrities also going to object to somebody? Is like, if it seems, or if there's an association which is created from the advertisement that, yes, this celebrity is associated with this brand, but the celebrity has absolutely no idea. Because, he or she has just won an event and come back, and they just see their photos splashed across media, and it seems, oh my God, they've got so many advertisements now. So all of this seems to be, then they might be in trouble, because obviously they will not be able to verify and, discharge their duties, responsible celebrities, of finding out whether the advertiser is in the position to substantiate the claim made or not. So then comes the problem, because then the celebrities, there's an impression there's an association which is there in the mind of the consumer that this A celebrity is endorsing A product. But actually there was no contract, there was nothing. Somebody was just using somebody else's image because, yes, the moment was theirs. So this is very, very important. These guidelines have come very recently. So the enforcement, I have not come across a judgment so far wherein, anybody has been sued or anybody has filed a claim under it. So I would love to, as soon as it has come, I would like to update that as well. So who should disclose, how to disclose? So that material connection is very important. And what is the responsibility flows on the celebrity as well, that, it should be in a particular way, that if there are any disclosures which are to be made, it should be clear. It should be in the live stream. It should be clearly placed. It should not be superimposed over something. It should not be something which is hidden in one small corner or something like that. So that, we'll come to the best practices which we can really adopt when we talk about this concept. Is best is, of course, these are not in any particular order that how we have to use them. But what I feel is always it's, I'll elaborate on each of them one by one. So consent is very important. So if you are using somebody else's work, somebody else's material, somebody else's created work, logo, design, their words or their photographs or the incidents or some particular association with a person, it's but natural, we are working, we operate in a very mature society in today's world. It's not very difficult to obtain a consent, or otherwise make sure that if the consent is not received, then we don't use it. So this kind of boundary line of ethicality and legality, when we cross, it's always possible to get a legal challenge. If there was no consent obtained, we don't really know, how is that person going to react to it, or how is it going to go? Because once something goes live in the market, it's there in the market. It's not possible for us to, even if we have to remove it, it's going to be a lot of costly affair. So, it's always better to ensure that the necessary consent is obtained. It's not just assumed. It's not just implied that, oh, I'm doing a great thing by doing something like this. I'm just using one photo. It gives them more publicity, but they have a right on it. So we must ensure that all kind of consents are always, always obtained, and nobody else's work is used without their prior permission. So this is a practice which must be insisted upon. It will save a lot of time. It will save a lot of money. It will, it will reduce litigation as well. Then again, originality. So now originality is something which cannot be really debated upon. The original work, you don't have anything to fear in that case, because if the work is original, if the work is created by oneself or by himself or herself, then the rights belong to that person who's created it. So the company does not have to bother about it. I'm using somebody else's stuff. So the question of consent does not arise at all. The original work is always, it's the safest to use as well. Then when we talk about disclaimer, so disclaimer is very important. Like we saw in one of the judgments, which the digital collectible judgment, which we saw, or, you know, where somebody is using the digital or somebody is using information, but they kind of disclaim that, no, there is no sponsorship or there is no association or some, in some way it is very clearly established that there's no misrepresentation to anybody. We are not really trying to show that this belongs to us when it doesn't. So when a fair use is made through appropriate disclosures or disclaimers, there is nothing to fear, and it will not, it will ensure that any kind of campaign which has taken so much of an effort to create and which is supposed to have the impact, it has the positive impact it is supposed to have and not negative impact. Because we must remember that in case we miss any of these aspects and, you know, any kind of legal issues arise, whether it is with respect to celebrity a celebrity claiming their particular rights or with respect to an IPR infringement, but if there was a clear disclosure made, there is some kind of, you know, okay, there was an honest use possible. So that is very, very important for us to remember to use broad, clear, easy, unambiguous thing. I mean, not trying to take an advantage of something which is not belonging to the to that particular person who's using it. Then I would also recommend highly, you know, to avoid any kind of hassles around marketing campaigns, whether it is around ambush marketing or parasite marketing. An assessment is very, very important, that what exactly is happening and whether any representation or association is possible in the minds of the viewer. It should be done by, from a third party's angle. The person may feel, oh, I am not doing anything wrong here. You know, there is no representation or association possible. But it's always better to just check it appropriately with, you know, with an open mindset and through the views of the, through the eyes of the viewer who's going to look at it. Is he going to associate it? Is he going to possibly connect the two things when I'm not really having the necessary consent or I'm not really having the necessary permission? Is that possible? So this assessment on a regular basis is very important. Like we saw two examples of the 2003 World Cup mascot. So in one case, they had Philips had just used the word. They just used the word World Cup, but they had, there was no usage of logo. There was no usage of any mascot. There was no nothing else. All and everything was being done. Like the tickets were booked officially through the official channel and the winners were going to be just, you know, it was a contest and the lucky winner just gets the, that as a prize. And it was a sponsored thing. So that was the campaign. And there was no usage of anybody else's logo or anything like that. But, you know, there the legal action was avoided, of course. And the defendant was held to be not guilty. But same situation, another person tried to use the logo. As soon as the logo is used, then there is a problem. So everybody is on the floor of World Cup. You'll see the World Cup logo everywhere, splashed across the television channels, splashed across the hoardings, newspapers, everywhere. It is there, but we cannot just take it, copy it and put it on our this thing and try to promote it. So this assessment or this, you know, every time trying to be extremely conscious, trying to be extremely mindful, what are we doing? Is it going to establish anything? If it is, then there is definitely the law is going to catch up. There is some or the other form of legal action which you will be caught into, you know, I mean, there are various ways possible around it, because moment marketing is something which is kind of a practice, which is there. As I said, you know, it's not, celebrity is not defined anywhere. We will not find this definition or this kind of thing in a statute book or in a particular law book per se, but you know, it exists. And if it does, then there are ways and means to cure that as well. That is all that I had to say. So if anybody has any queries, I would be happy to answer it.
In some cases, say, we see that in almost every town there is Bombay hair cutting saloon, and they use this photos, images of say Amitabh Bachchan, Shah Rukh Khan, and in almost town, and they do not obtain any permission.
Correct.
But even the stars consider it as their popularity index and do not say file any cases, or they do not claim any IPR in such cases.
Yeah.
So because there is, I think there is no intention to
deceive.
Yes, to deceive the customers.
Hmm.
So, is it, ethical or illegal?
That's what I was saying. That, you know, I mean, I remember I had gone to a particular, it was on a trip somewhere, and I remember seeing some toffees which had the photograph of a movie actress on it. So, I was 100% sure that she has not gone and endorsed that lollipop really. But you know, I mean, the person who was creating that lollipop must have been a big fan of the actress, and she said that, you know, I think she did not object to it. So when we do something which is unintentional and which is not objected to, you know, it's a different situation. Because it's also difficult to believe that Shah Rukh Khan or Amitabh would have gone and really endorsed that particular small barber shop somewhere in that town. We just have to wait if something happens on it, really.
Yes, but when there was recently a case when this Kaun Banega Crorepati messages were sent on WhatsApp with intention to defraud or commit cyber fraud.
So Amitabh Bachchan
had to go to Delhi High Court, and Delhi High Court restrained the people from misusing the say Amitabh Bachchan's name, and said that he also has the right to privacy and it should not be used.
Yes, he has a right to privacy and publicity both. Correct.
To defraud the WhatsApp users. It was held that he has a right to privacy also.
Correct. So all this, what we are saying is it's a practical example. So, you know, but the right is always there. They can always go and sue them also. And another concept which is always there in IPR is called acquiescence. Acquiescence is something wherein, you know, you sit over your rights for a very long time and then you lose it. Like if somebody has allowed another person to grow in that particular business for decades together and not bothered to sue them, then suddenly if somebody gets up and says, then, you know, the court may also take a different view. So I think what I feel is that with these new endorsement know-hows which has come, so yes, saloon is a different example, but if somebody is allowing their image to be used everywhere and allowing it to be like a kind of an endorsement without having any connection with them, then there might be a problem. Because I showed those recent guidelines which have come, now they've just come in March 2023 from the Consumer Affairs.
Yes, these are new guidelines. Yes,
these are new guidelines, and they put us responsibility on the celebrity also, that, you know, they should make sure before they endorse something that, you know, the claim which is being made in the advertisement is capable of being substantiated. So we are yet to see them. You know, I have not come across any case around this. So
yes, I would just like to add two cases. Yes. One case was of Dabang 2010. Hmm. In that, they used this line that this Munni Badnaam Hui Darling Tere Liye Jhandu Baam Hui Tere Liye. So Jhandu Pharmaceutical said that we are a reputed pharmaceutical company and you can't use our name.
Correct.
So they argued that yes, it is not used in a derogatory sense, but it is used in a soothing sense. But then I think there was out of court settlement, and then they used this combined advertisement over the television. Then there was another case in Dabang 2. Again, they used this chipkai de sahiya fevicol se. So fevicol is a trademark of PD Light Industries Limited, and they did not but at the time they had learned from their previous experience, and in Dabang 2 2012 they took advance permission from PD Light Industries, and since beginning there were advertisements on television, combined advertisements.
Both
got advantage of it, and there was no court case in that matter.
That's the whole point. You know, if you go and take a consent, so that's why I was saying that in a best practices manner, you first of all, you try to be original. If that originality, or if you're using somebody else's, make sure that there is a consent. Because once it goes in public, then it is very difficult to, you know, then try and take a consent, because then the situation has changed completely. So consent is not going to come so easily from the other side. So, you know, that we must remember, of course, that, you know, when we are taking somebody else's thing, we need to be very, very careful about it.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you, madam, for a very informative session. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. It's a pleasure. I'm glad you shared, you know, your views on this.
My doubt is, what course of action can be pursued against a YouTuber who engages in compensated product reviews without actually using the said products and fails to openly disclose this information in the video's description?
You want to take action against some YouTuber who's criticizing a product or who's endorsing a product. What is it?
They are reviewing it. At the same time, they are not disclosing in their description that they have reviewed it just because they have got the payment from the company.
So you can definitely take action against him. See, these new endorsement know-hows which have come, the endorsement guidelines of this Department of Consumer Affairs. So they specifically say that, you know, anybody is supposed to disclose it. It has to be disclosed in a very clear language. So consumer action can definitely be taken against a YouTuber who's kind of doing paid promotion, but gives an impression that it's a personal, you know, it's a personal endorsement or something like that.
Okay, so the remedy lies in filing a complaint in the consumer.
Yeah. You can definitely take an action. And I think the new guidelines which are there, so they give some, you can do it through the website as well.
But how will a viewer fall under the definition of a consumer? Because
no, he's getting influenced, no? So we can tell, so that matter can definitely be reported. That,
okay, you know, misleading advertisement. Yeah,
but that person, the YouTuber, is he a influencer or is he a celebrity or is he just, you know, I mean, has like less than 10 followers? All of those factors will matter. So whether it is also worth that legal action also, we should, you know, analyze that.
The definition of an influencer is one whose account is verified, is it?
There are some guidelines in it. So those consumer guidelines, definitely there is some remedy. If somebody is trying to, you know, show something as a unpaid promotion, whereas actually he has some kind of a material connection with the company. So all of those things are covered, you know, whether you are getting directly paid. Sometimes they may not be directly paid, but they get some other kind of a favor from that company. So that also forms a part of material connection. So there is a remedy, and YouTubers are also very much they are virtual influencers, no? So they are very much in that ambit.
Aarti, I wanted to ask you, what are the like different clauses that are incorporated in these kind of agreements? Any clauses that you can shed light on?
See, if you are doing an agreement with a celebrity or with an influencer, or it depends, like, really which kind of agreement are we saying? So we'll take it step by step. So first we saw the first challenge was when the celebrity rights, like, you know, I shared the example of Sindhu. So Sindhu went and, you know, she, it was reported that she was planning to sue some brands because, you know, her image was used. So here, if we are taking an agreement, it has to be kind of a consent thing, which is very categorically giving somebody permission to use the image or use one particular image. So it's always, when we talk of an agreement, Malvika, it's the clearer the better. Don't leave anything to chance. Make it very clear what consent agreement is there, what is the photo which is going to be used, for how many times can it be used, what is the duration of it. And at the same time, a clear permission should be obtained. Or if we are looking at an agreement when it comes to an IPR issue, like, you know, if we are going to use somebody else's a logo of a particular event. So again, we need to look at an agreement of that nature. If we are looking at an agreement for an endorsement, so endorsement also needs to be categorically mentioned that there might be certain restrictive things also in it, that, you know, you will endorse this list of products or that set of products. How will you endorse it? How will it be used? How will it be shown? So clear agreements, clear consents should be there very categorically. When we talk about, and as we say about this agreements in this nature, the disclaimers are also very important. So, you know, the endorsement know-hows have made it very clear how should the disclaimer be incorporated. If you are incorporating certain disclosures or disclaimers, they need to be prominent. They should be at a place where it is hard to miss it. Like if I see your screen right now, you have said you may connect with us on, you know, the font of everything on this slide is same. But if you want to put it, and if you want to put a disclosure here, it should be in the same font. It should be like in the same thing, like after the WhatsApp number, there should be something in the same font, in the same color. I cannot write all this in English and then put the disclosure in, say, a South Indian language or in a, you know, in a foreign language, which nobody really understands. That is very important. Yeah. Disclosure guidelines are also very important to adhere to. And I think once parties decide that, you know, I want to make this very clear that what is mine and what is not, I think it naturally comes, and we as mature adults, we are used to seeing many things. So we will make sure that, you know, we put it in the right way. But the problem arises when, you know, somebody wants to hide something, when somebody wants to say, acha, theek hai, this is all there, but you may connect with us, you will say all this here. And just to give an example, I'm sure PLEA doesn't do that. But if there are certain additional conditions or if there's some additional payment, you'll write it in the left corner in one very small font, which is kind of getting merged with the background. And once the person registers on your website and you start calling him again and again because you've got his data. So all those practices, you know, that's something which needs to be avoided. I think the crux of all these aspects is more to do with the person's intention, honesty, and of course, a case-to-case assessment. Every time, what is happening, where is it used, what is used, you know, all those kind of things we need to remember.
Okay, so here the onus might lie on the manufacturer or the brand, right? Because the influencer might not be so legally sound.
Yeah, but if the influencer does not also take an action, then it will be assumed, no, that the influencer also has got a hidden benefit. The problem is that now, because see, if the influencer does not do something for like 6 months, and, you know, he is also aware that, yeah, this is happening. He has not got any monetary benefit, but he has not objected to it. as I think Virendraji mentioned at that point in time, because the influencer or the celebrity feels, hi, it's good publicity for me. But tomorrow, but after 6 months, suppose something goes wrong majorly with that product.
Yeah.
Like, you know, majorly wrong. You know, we've seen some products being, you know, I mean, something really just, you know, there's a mistake which was there and a latent defect or something which came out after so much of time. Then he does not have the option after 6 months to say, oh, I was not getting paid. They were just using mine without permission. So now okay. The responsibility is also on the endorser or on the influencer. He needs to make sure that, you know, it is being used properly. And okay, the advertisement, like, like, you know, if there's a claim made, the claim is possible to be substantiated. Yeah. So, you know, the celebrity cannot just sit back and say, acha, the manufacturer will deal with it. Somebody might come after him also.
Yeah, like the Maggie in 2015. I remember Maggie was on.
Maggie, Dairy Milk.